attending the webinar. My name is Doug Tozer. I'm Director Waterbirds and Wetlands here at Birds Canada. And with me today is Kathy Jones, our volunteer manager. And thank you very much to Kathy for arranging and organizing this entire webinar. Much appreciated. First, some bookkeeping items. The presentation I've prepared combined with the answers I've put together to the questions that were submitted online prior to the webinar, that all pretty well fills the time we have available. Therefore, we encourage you to submit questions if you have them during the webinar using the online chat tool. But due to anticipated time constraints, we'll answer them if we can later through other venues. As well, we remind you to please mute your microphone if it hasn't been muted already. Okay, I'd like to start by explaining just what it is we'd like to accomplish here today. What you see is a graphic depicting the flow of Great Lakes MMP communications. In gray at the top are some of the main science products produced using the program's data. So these are things like population trends, total population sizes. We haven't done a lot of that, but we plan on doing more of it very soon. Estimates of species distributions and species habitat relationships. Then in turn, we communicate these results to diverse audiences shown in blue at the bottom. So that includes things like participants, policymakers, academics, and the public. What we'd like to focus on here today is peer-reviewed research, and specifically that which has been published in the last year or two, or has recently been submitted for publication but hasn't been published yet, but hopefully will be. For these papers, we'd like to convey high-level methods and results and show how the analyses are being put to good use for wetland conservation. There are seven papers that address four topics that we'd like to give you an overview of. The four topics shown in orange are wetland management, conservation planning, experimental design, and detection probability. Now, it's a busy slide. We don't intend for you to take in all the titles, but not to worry, we'll deal with each of these papers in turn. Following the detection probability papers, we'll discuss implications that some of these findings have in terms of future changes to the Great Lakes MMP field protocols. Plus, at the very end, we'll have a few updates and other helpful tidbits for you. And of course, following the presentation, we'll attempt to answer the questions that were asked online prior to the webinar. Okay, so first, wetland management. There are various techniques to enhance the quality of marshes for wildlife. These methods include water level manipulation to mimic natural water level dynamics, cattle exclusion to prevent disturbance and nutrient loading, planting of trees and surrounding uplands to buffer pollution and runoff, and control of invasive plants, particularly the non-native invasive form of Phragmites. We often hear about how these techniques benefit ducks and other waterfowl, as they are the main wetland management techniques used under the North American Waterfowl Management Plan, affectionately known as NAWMP for short, although some people prefer NOMP. I'm sort of a NAWMP kind of guy. Indeed, results from the State of Canada's birds show waterfowl on the very top line of this graph as one of the few groups of birds that are increasing over time across Canada. What we hear much less about is how these NAWMP wetland management techniques benefit other marsh breeding birds and frogs. There's been a handful of studies scattered throughout northeastern North America that have looked at this topic. The studies we're aware of are shown here. These studies are valuable and they tell us quite a bit. For instance, they show that some marsh birds and frogs are positively influenced by NAWMP management techniques. But in each case, these studies had some limitations. These limitations include things like small sample sizes, short time since initiation of management, small wetland sizes, limited spatial scales, and none of the studies made adjustments for differences in detection probability, which we'll hear more about later in the talk. As well, none of the studies look specifically at the benefits of control of invasive Phragmites for marsh birds and frogs before and after control, a timely topic that many conservation groups wish to know more about. So in response, we used Great Lakes MMP data to fill in these knowledge gaps. In this first paper seen here, we measured occupancy of marsh birds and frogs in marshes managed as conservation projects under NAWAMP compared to nearby unmanaged marshes throughout southern Ontario. So occupancy in this case is simply the proportion of locations that are occupied by at least one individual of a species. And it's given as a number, such as 0.2, which would indicate, for example, that a species occurs at 20% of locations. And because of the extensive nature of the Great Lakes MMP throughout southern Ontario, we were able to overcome the limitations of the previous studies that we mentioned earlier. For instance, we had a much larger sample size, as you can see in the map here, with about 40 NAWAMP conservation project marshes and a similar number of nearby unmanaged marshes, with hundreds of MMP survey stations scattered throughout these many wetlands, as well as lots of different times since management, lots of different marsh sizes, and so on. So here's what we found. Here you see the main results for all of the 22 species as effect sizes. Birds in the graph on the left, frogs in the graph on the right. So what's plotted for each species is the difference between estimated occupancy in NAWAMP conservation project wetlands minus the occupancy in unmanaged wetlands, such that positive effect sizes, which are plotted above the horizontal dashed line, mean the species had higher occupancy in NAWAMP conservation project wetlands. And conversely, negative effect sizes plotted below the horizontal dashed line mean occupancy was higher at unmanaged wetlands. As well, for species for which occupancy was significantly higher in a statistical sense in conservation project wetlands are shown with solid black circles. And as you can see, occupancy of all species except mute swan and eastern gray tree frog was higher at conservation project wetlands compared to unmanaged wetlands, as the effect sizes are all above the horizontal dashed line. And a little under half of the species, occupancy was significantly higher at conservation project wetlands compared to unmanaged wetlands, as shown by the solid black dots. Now, notably, five of the species showing higher or significantly higher occupancy at NAWAMP conservation project wetlands are listed as being at risk or of conservation concern in Ontario, shown here with red blobs. And populations of all of these five species, plus another four shown here with lighter red blobs for a total of nine species, are known to be declining throughout the southern Great Lakes region. Therefore, conservation projects under NAWAMP appear to be especially useful for conserving and recovering populations of various declining, at-risk, and priority conservation concern marsh bird and frog species. In the second paper dealing with wetland management, we used Great Lakes MMP data to look at the change in occurrence of marsh breeding birds and frogs before and after control of Phragmites. Now, various studies have previously compared these two animal groups at survey locations within Phragmites patches compared to locations outside, but no study so far had compared what happens before and after control of Phragmites at the same survey locations. So what we did was use data from the Great Lakes MMP to document occurrence of marsh breeding birds and frogs 1 to 5 years before and 1 to 5 years after control of Phragmites at various survey stations at Kettle Point on Lake Huron and Rondo and Long Point on Lake Erie. We chose these three wetland complexes because each had active Phragmites control programs. About half of the survey stations, Phragmites was controlled, shown on the maps as blue circles. At the other survey stations, no control of Phragmites occurred, shown as orange triangles. But we monitored all of the survey stations before and after control of Phragmites, regardless of whether control happened at the station or not. This allowed us to document simultaneous changes in birds and frogs that had nothing to do with the control of Phragmites, So things like simultaneous changes in water levels or who knows what else. So here's what we found. Clear statistically significant increases in species richness shown in the top graph and total abundance shown in the bottom graph of marsh breeding bitterns and rails of conservation concern in relation to control of invasive Phragmites. And as you can see in the top graph, one gets an increase of about one of these species with control, shown by the uptick in the blue line where control occurred relative to the orange line where no control happened. And as you can see in the bottom graph, one gets an increase of about two individuals of these species of conservation concern with control, again shown by the uptick in the blue line where control occurred relative to the orange line where no control happened. By contrast, we found no influence of control of invasive Phragmites on species richness or an index of abundance based on calling codes of frogs. Although the story might have been different if we had had more detailed data on abundance, say for both tadpoles and adults separately throughout the season, for example. This type of abundance data might have revealed changes that we are unable to detect with our occurrence data or our index of abundance. As you can see here in both graphs, there's no uptick in the blue lines where control occurred relative to the orange lines where no control happened. These two papers dealing with wetland management topics are important because in both cases they're being used by conservation agencies and partners to complete more wetland conservation work on the ground. Ducks Unlimited Canada, for example, is using the first paper to leverage more dollars to do more wetland conservation work. And the numerous conservation groups who are leading the control of Phragmites at Kettle Point, Rondo, and Long Point now have more fuel with the second paper to justify acquiring more resources to continue with control of Phragmites in these locations and perhaps others. Thus, both of these papers are helping bring about improved wetland habitat quality on the ground, and in turn are helping increase numbers of marsh breeding birds and frogs across the landscape. This is true impact, we're hoping, in the most extreme sense of the word. Okay, now we can move on to conservation planning. In Southern Ontario, the Eastern Habitat Joint Venture is one of the main bodies responsible for a great deal of wetland conservation work. Now, their critical contributions come from various other groups like conservation authorities and land trusts. To date, much of the funding under the North American Waterfowl Management Plan for this work has been used by the joint venture to target wetlands in areas that benefit waterfowl, meaning ducks, geese, and swans. This has been done in the waterfowl priority habitat areas you see on the map, which are areas that have been identified as important for waterfowl species, and has resulted in an extensive network of well-conserved and well-managed marshes for the benefit of waterfowl and other wildlife. Recently, migratory bird joint ventures have been tasked with expanding their focus from waterfowl to all birds under the guidance of the North American Bird Conservation Initiative, or affectionately known as NABC for short. In the case of Ontario Eastern Habitat Joint Venture, this transition to all bird conservation is to initially involve all wetland-dependent priority bird species of conservation concern in southern Ontario. So what we did in this next paper was use Great Lakes MMP bird and habitat data to create species habitat relationship models for most of the MMP focal bird species and marsh wren. As you see here, this allowed us to quantify relationships between occupancy and various types of habitat for each of these species. In this case, relationships between occupancy and marsh cover is shown on the right. These relationships in turn allowed us to predict where across the landscape of all of southern Ontario is best for these species in terms of things like surrounding wetland, urban, agricultural, and forest cover, and various other influences like climate. That's what you see here. The yellow, orange, and red on the map are areas with the highest probability of supporting the largest number of non-waterfowl marsh breeding bird species, and are therefore the best places for future wetland conservation work that will benefit them all the most. Also shown on the map are the existing waterfowl-based priority habitat areas with right-hand diagonal hatching, and our proposed marsh breeding bird priority habitat areas with left-hand diagonal hatching surrounded by bold black lines, which lie outside the existing priority areas. It's our vision that the Ontario Eastern Habitat Joint Venture will expand its on-the-ground wetland conservation work into our proposed marsh breeding bird priority areas, which combined with the existing waterfowl priority areas will be an excellent step towards all bird conservation in the region. So again, like the other papers we saw earlier, we can see that this paper dealing with conservation planning is important because it will be used by conservation agencies and partners to complete more impactful wetland conservation work on the ground. Okay, next let's look at experimental design. There are two elements of the Great Lakes MMP that we're often challenged on by peer reviewers when we go to publish Great Lakes MMP data in the scientific literature. One question reviewers often ask us is, how reliable or how good are citizen scientists at identifying and detecting marsh breeding birds? The other question is, how representative are opportunistically chosen or volunteer chosen survey stations? Meaning, how representative are opportunistically chosen stations of all the possible stations that could be chosen throughout the entire landscape under study? So in this next paper, we attempted to answer both questions in one go. We generated results based on data collected by Great Lakes MMP citizen scientists at opportunistically chosen stations shown by blue circles on the map, a sort of business as usual type of scenario. And we compared these results to results based on data collected by professionals at randomly chosen, spatially balanced stations shown by orange triangles on the map throughout southern Ontario. As we expected, we found that citizen scientists perform quite well compared to professionals. In the top left, we see that citizen scientists at their opportunistically chosen survey stations, shown in blue, found the same number of species of bitterns and rails across all 3 years of the study as professionals did at their randomly chosen stations, shown in orange. In the two graphs at the top right, citizen scientists also found the same occupancy of all of the focal species except Virginia rail. Here we see least bittern and pied-billed grebe as examples. Same for habitat in the two graphs at the bottom left. Citizen scientists and professionals had similar within-station characteristics. Here we see emergent vegetation and open water as examples. And again, the same message in the two graphs at the bottom right for landscape features surrounding survey stations. In this case, we see urban cover and wetland cover out to a distance of 3 kilometers as examples. The only difference of consequence that we found between citizen scientists and professionals, as shown in the top left graph, was that citizen scientists chose relatively more Great Lakes coastal survey stations, as shown by the higher blue line for citizen scientists compared to the lower orange line for professionals. The difference in turn appeared to cause the discrepancy we saw in occupancy between the two groups of observers for Virginia rail, as shown in the top right graph, where citizen scientists detected lower occupancy of Virginia rail compared to professionals, as shown by the lower blue line compared to the higher orange line. We know from other analyses that Virginia rail occurs less commonly at coastal stations compared to inland stations, where it is more common. So by surveying relatively more coastal stations and relatively fewer inland stations, citizen scientists are reporting totals for this species that are accurate at coastal stations, but biased low at inland stations. And this is shown in the bottom left graph, where the two lines for Virginia Rail are pretty much the same at coastal stations, but by contrast, for Virginia Rail at inland stations in the bottom right graph, the blue line is lower than the orange line. The overall take-home message from this paper is that trained Great Lakes MMP citizen scientists who opportunistically choose survey stations yield results similar to professionals who survey pre-assigned, randomly selected survey stations, with the exception of some bias in coastal versus inland stations and Virginia Rail, which we can work to correct. This overall result is very important because it validates the Great Lakes MMP's opportunistic citizen science approach in the minds of skeptics, which will in turn allow us to publish more and better information that our conservation partners can then use to complete even more impactful wetland conservation work on the ground to benefit these species. So let's look next at detection probability. In everyday terms, here's what we mean by detection. Imagine yourself doing an MMP bird or frog survey like you see above. You see the species, you record the species you hear or see. In other words, you record the species you detect within the survey station. Now that's all fine and dandy, but what about the individuals of species that were in the station during your survey, but never became visible or never called during the survey, so that you had no chance of detecting them even though they were there? Quantifying that is what is called detection probability, or simply detectability, or in some cases, perceptibility. In other words, it's estimating the probability or chance that one will detect a species or an individual of a species if it's present in a survey station during a survey. And like occupancy, detection is reported as a proportion between 0 and 1, such as 0.2, which in this case would indicate a 20% chance of detection. The way we go about estimating detection probability is by using the frequency of detections across repeated surveys or survey intervals at stations where the species or individuals of a species are known or suspected to be present. So these repeated surveys can be different visits to a station within a given year, as seen at the top, or they can be the different 5-minute or 1-minute intervals within a single survey or visit, shown in the middle and at the bottom. Or they can be multiples of these simultaneously, depending on the type of math being used to estimate detection. So what we did in these last three papers was estimate detection probability in relation to various different influences that we anticipated might be useful for improving the MMP field protocols. The influences included things like date, temperature, whether it was dark or light out, cloud, wind, precipitation, etc. For instance, here we see relationships for detection probability for each of three species of frogs in relation to these types of variables. We also looked at how detection probability varies according to factors like the total length of the survey and in relation to the broadcasts. For example, here we see differences in detection probability of least bittern and Virginia rail during 5-minute, 10-minute, or 15-minute surveys, or differences in detection from 5-minute or 10-minute counts depending on if the 5 or 10 minutes was at the beginning or the end of the 15-minute survey, and so on. Based on these various analyses, we recommend the following future changes to the Great Lakes MMP field protocols. Reduce minimum temperature for bird surveys from 16 to 0 Celsius. Reduce temperature for the third frog visit from 16 to 13 Celsius. Survey morning or evening for birds as most convenient. And reduce length of bird surveys from 15 to 10 minutes. The recommendations from these three papers dealing with detection probability are important because they will result in more efficient surveying, which will result in participants having more time available to survey more stations per season if they wish, which will boost sample sizes and provide more statistical power to produce better science products to allow us and our conservation partners to complete even more impactful wetland conservation work on the ground to benefit marsh breeding birds and frogs. Okay, we'd like to start wrapping things up by providing a few updates and other helpful tidbits. You will likely be familiar with the current Great Lakes MMP report shown here. A heads up that we'll be working on an update to this report. It's scheduled to be released to the public sometime late this coming winter or in early spring 2020. You'll also likely be familiar with the program's current guide booklets. We will be revising these booklets to reflect the field protocol recommendations that we discussed earlier in the presentation, along with a number of other improvements. We also plan to consolidate the three booklets into a single booklet and to have full versions available in French. This new and updated guide booklet is scheduled to be released in time for the 2021 field season. We'd like to draw your attention to a series of articles we recently completed in Ontario Birds, which is the Journal of the Ontario Field Ornithologists. The three-part series of articles overviews some of the current environmental and ecological issues for Lake Erie, with emphasis on the implications for the numerous bird species that depend on the lake for nesting and migration. The first of the three articles, shown on the left, deals with invasive Phragmites and includes analyses based on Great Lakes MMP data. All three of the articles are available in their entirety with the generous permission of Ontario Birds on the Great Lakes MMP website shown at the bottom, birdscanada.org/volunteer/GLMMP. And then the links to the articles are on the left-hand side. And finally, you may have noticed that we are no longer called Bird Studies Canada. We've simplified our operating name to Birds Canada, and we now have a new logo. It's very important to note, however, that what we do and what we are all about will remain unchanged, including our overall mission and vision. Okay, we'd like to end by thanking all of our conservation partners and supporters. In particular, we'd like to thank the many Great Lakes MMP citizen scientists and regional coordinators who give so generously with their time so the program can be such a huge success. We hope that today's presentation was interesting and useful in bringing you up to date on recent peer-reviewed research that uses Great Lakes MMP data. We try really hard to strategically analyze and report the program's findings to in turn bring about successful wetland conservation on the ground. And we really hope that you liked what you've seen here today. If you would like more information on any of the papers we talked about today, or would like copies of the ones that have been published, then please get in touch with me. My email is at the top of the screen. Now I'll try my best to answer your questions that were submitted online ahead of the webinar. Okay, so the first one asks, what can be done about extended flooding on the Trent River and Great Lakes? Some flooding during spring runoff is normal, but this year was the longest that I've seen in over 10 years. One has to wonder what role the hydroelectric dam is playing in this situation. The bird and animal population is being displaced. Much of the fauna has disappeared. The trees are uprooting and dying back. Okay, so this is a very timely topic given the record high water we've seen this year. It's also very challenging to figure out the answers to these questions. But one thing we can tell you are the results of a study that we've been collaborating on that looks at the influence of water level changes on marsh breeding birds at a broad scale across coastal wetlands in all of the Great Lakes, in both the US and Canada. This work is part of Tara Homan's master's thesis at the University of Wisconsin-Green Bay, some of which you see here. The results show species richness of marsh breeding birds in Great Lakes coastal wetlands during low water levels, indicated by the blue box plots on the left during 2011 to 2013, compared to species richness of marsh breeding birds in Great Lakes coastal wetlands during high water levels, indicated by the green box plots on the right during 2016 to 2018. And you can see overall in the top left graph that species richness of marsh breeding birds was significantly higher by a couple of species or so during high water, as was the case for all of the lakes individually as seen in the other graphs, significantly so for Huron and Michigan. So even though habitat may disappear, and marsh breeding birds may disappear with it due to high water at any particular marsh at a local scale, as experienced due to erosion by our questioner. Overall, at a broad scale, these results tell us that high water in Great Lakes coastal wetlands benefit marsh breeding birds generally, because overall there's an increase in habitat rather than a decrease, as dry parts of coastal marshes become wet again and therefore usable for nesting by these species. Okay, the next one asks, this year, summer and into fall, we observed a very high number of juvenile leopard frogs on our property, both near the lake and farther inland. We've never seen so many before. Was this an isolated local phenomenon, or was this more widespread? Good question. Hard for us to answer at the moment until all of the 2019 MMP data is submitted and error checked, which will happen soon, but not yet. But what we can look at is the long-term broad-scale trajectory of northern leopard frog populations based on Great Lakes MMP data up to and including 2018, which is what you see here. In the last 3 years, the population at this broad scale appears to be decreasing rather than increasing. So the increase that the questioner is experiencing in their marsh does not appear to be happening at this broader scale. But it will be very interesting to see what the 2019 data say for this species. Perhaps we will see a broad scale uptick in the population that will match the questioner's local scale experience. Stay tuned for up-to-date results in the soon-to-be-updated program report and the next issue of the program's newsletter, the Marsh Monitor. Okay, this next one asks, of the target bird species in our MMP, are some species more likely to reply to the broadcast calls? And are we likely to get callbacks early in the spring, or the second or third visits? Okay, for the target or focal bird species, some of them definitely respond more strongly to the broadcasts than others. So shown in these graphs is detection probability for each of the broadcast species during each of the first 10 1-minute intervals during surveys. So you can see in the top left graph that the increase in detection is barely noticeable for least bittern during its broadcast during minute 6. In the bottom left graph, the increase in detection is sort of moderate or midway for pied-billed grebe during its broadcast during minute 10. And then by contrast, in the other graphs for all the rest of the species, there are huge and very dramatic increases in detection during the minute where their broadcasts are played. It's quite revealing to see these types of graphs because they show that for most of the focal species that we are really interested in monitoring, the broadcasts are essential because they're increasing detection from say 10 to 20% or so on average without broadcasts, up to 50 to 60% or so with broadcasts. So well worth the effort of dragging those broadcast units out to the marsh and fiddling with bailing batteries and who knows what else and so on. One makes all that effort to go out there to the stations, you might as well have the best chances of detecting the species you really came out to get. As for the second part of the question, here we see how detection changes over the course of the different visits during a season for each of the focal bird species. So detection probability for some of these species changes across visits, but for others it doesn't. Detection for American bittern shown in the top left graph changes quite dramatically, with the highest detection earlier in the season on the first visit. But by contrast, detection for common gallinule shown in the graph third from the left in the top row increases throughout the season, with detection highest on the last visit. And the other species show various other patterns. Again, these types of graphs are quite revealing because they show that different focal bird species are more likely to be detected on different visits at different times of the season, which shows why it is useful to make multiple visits to each of your stations in a particular season, because we don't want to miss any of these species if they really are present. Okay. This last one asks, if focal species not observed for many years, should survey continue? At least one of my stations is becoming more terrestrial. Google Earth will show this, I think. The quick answer to this one is yes. Definitely please continue to survey stations regardless of whether focal bird species are observed or not. This is partly because one of the primary objectives of the program is to track population changes over time. And we can do a really good job of that if we track a large number of the same stations over time. So if the habitat is changing at your station and the birds are changing with it, then we want to capture that by continuing to survey the station across years. Now, having said that, I thought I would show some data from an article we did in the program's newsletter, The Marsh Monitor, back in 2013. Shown in the table is the percentage of surveys on which various species have been detected over the many years of the program that it's been operating. For birds in the left column, you can see the percentage varies from as much as 84% at the top for red-winged blackbird down to less than 1% at the bottom for extremely rare species of rails. Of relevance to the question is that even the most common focal bird species, the Virginia rail, it's only observed on 15% of surveys. The rest of the focal species are observed on only 3 to 9% of surveys. So most MMP surveyors on most surveys do not detect any focal bird species at all. And yet data from those surveys and those stations without detection of these species are just as important as ones with detections. Okay, so once again, we'd like to thank all of our conservation partners and supporters. As well, we'd like to thank all of you for your support and for attending the webinar today. We see that there are a number of questions that have been submitted during the webinar, and we thank you for these. We'll consider each of them and attempt to answer them if we can later through other venues. Many thanks again for attending today's webinar. And have a good day.
Hi, everybody. It's Kathy here. Thank you so much for attending. I will send you some information as soon as I have things pulled together. Questions are still welcome if you have any. And just have a great day.